I hope you all can hear me out there. This is Zakiya Carr Johnson. Hola, hello, alo to all our Sister Disruptors and friends with us live today and those checking us out on the replay. We see you and thank you so much for joining us when you can. At Black Women Disrupt, we are connecting with Sister Disruptors in a new way in 2020. We're still committed to inspire, challenge, co-create, and transform our societies by working with businesses and social enterprises led by Black women in the Americas and around the world. However, we will be curating more intimate conversations and bringing the voices of Sister Disruptors to you over the next few weeks and bringing you other opportunities to connect and grow together. So good morning. It's 11 a.m. We normally broadcast live at a 4 p.m. date, but our guest is going to join us from Qatar, which is the other side of the world. So with our special guest, we want to explore life after a pivot, to learn lessons from sisters doing this and living this moment just like us, women around the world who can help us reconnect to ourselves, to our brilliance and our missions. Women who will remind us that we still have a unique purpose in life, that this struggle is not over, that even if we are in the midst of some of the most challenging times, we can build, grow, and build again. There's so much more we can and will do to support our families and our communities and transform the societies in which we live. So we've also been asked by friends and colleagues what they can do to support our work. There are all kinds of ways you can support Black women entrepreneurs. We've identified a few ways to show solidarity and support Black women every day. Number one, buy from Black women-owned businesses. Number two, fund Black women-led organizations. Put money in the hands of women who know how to do the work. And number three, invest in our communities. And that is in any number of ways that Black women and women of color are helping you understand that they would like your partnership. So, all right, tudo bem? We're going to mix it up today and conduct parts of our discussion in Portuguese and English. That's right. We're doing it a little bit different. Please have patience. Para as pessoas que estão assistindo em português, hoje vamos fazer uma sessão mista. Uma sessão que tenha perguntas em espanhol, em português. Espanhol hoje, não. Em português e em inglês. E let us know, everyone, if you're watching, post a question for Dr. Luana Ozemela below. We're so pleased to have Dr. Luana Ozemela. I'm going to bring her in with us while I read her illustrious biography. there she is.
Hey, Zakiya, how are you?
Hey, I'm well. We are so pleased to have Dr. Luana with us. She is the founder and CEO of DIMA, the first management consulting firm established in Qatar, which focuses on bolstering bilateral cooperation and investment promotion between Qatar and Latin America. And we're going to ask her to explain what all of that means. Some of us have development backgrounds, and some of us really are curious to know what this is about. She's built upon her 20 years of experience, you guys, in consulting and international development in more than 20 countries. DIMA has been advising multilateral banks, startups, large corporations, foundations, and universities on business strategy and development and social development impact. Dr. Luana was actually born in the city of Porto Alegre, in the heart of the Southern Afro-Brazilian movement. So she's not a stranger to many of us in Latin America and the Caribbean. She graduated in economics from the Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Sul and worked for Hewlett-Packard before migrating to the UK to pursue her studies. She received a PhD in economics from the University of Aberdeen and served at the Inter-American Development Bank in Washington, D.C. on various loan operations and research in Latin America for several years. Actually, we'll talk about how we met. She founded DIMA in 2019 in Doha, and she has published widely and actively is actively involved in nonprofit boards in Qatar, in Brazil, and in Nigeria, I believe. But she'll tell us more about that work. She also is doing work to promote FIFA and the 2022 World Cup. So without further ado, I hate to read these long things, but we have to know the people we're talking to. I want you all to meet Dr. Luana Ozimela and my good friend.
Thank you so much, Zakia. Thank you.
Obrigada. Thank you for staying up late enough to hang out with us here.
No, it's a pleasure. This is my pleasure.
Fantastic. So I have a few questions. Temos algumas perguntas para você. And we're going to mix it up. Vamos ser mixtas hoje. Vamos conversar em duas línguas. We're going to speak in two languages today. And we're not going to translate every single thing we talk about. But we're going to alternate, okay? Are you ready to play this game with us?
Tá bom, desafio.
Desafio total.
Fala metade da frase em português. The other half in English.
We're going to try. Because in order to cross these borders, we have to communicate with one another. Yes. And the best way to do that is by learning another language, trying to communicate through language with another person. And sometimes through vision and other ways. So let's get started. The first question is going to be in English. When did you know you were an entrepreneur?
I knew I was an entrepreneur, I think, very early on in my life. I used to, every summer, we used to go as a family to a small beach nearby Porto Alegre called Cidreira. And I am a lover of stones and, natural stones, jewelry that is made from natural stuff. And I used to make them. I used to, make jewelry just for fun. But then at some point I realized, I need money to buy my ice cream. I need, money to buy my stuff. And I started selling some of this stuff at the beach just for people passing by,
Right.
But I realized that it took me so long to sell, the jewelry, it took longer to sell than actually to make them. And I just thought to myself, let me just talk with that guy at the corner down there that sells different stuff. And let's see if he'll buy from me, I think. And then I just took all my stuff and I told him, look, it's taking too long. I just need to make money. Can you buy this stuff? And he started buying. So I think that was the very first time I realized, I was actually had the feel for business because I just wanted to maximize profit and minimize, maximize by wholesaler, So, but of course, I think it was that moment that I was like, yeah, I like this, selling stuff. I felt I convinced him of the value of it, and the art and stuff like that. And he gave me the best, price possible. But of course, that's just the summer thing. It was later on that then I opened my first company when I was 19. Then it was like an official enterprise, and in Brazil, the law then, and I believe till today, you cannot open a company until you are 21. So I had to be emancipated by my parents.
Yes. I didn't know the story, Luana.
We have to go to court. Can you believe this? I wanted to open my first IT company because I studied IT in the a vocational training. And I got offers, to provide services as a company, and I didn't have a company. So my parents took me to the courts and, emancipated me. Till today, my national ID says emancipated, that kind of thing. So I always just, emancipate yourself,
Emancipate yourself, sister. Yeah.
So that's when then I really invested in a career as an entrepreneur. Of course, later on, I went into the corporate world, to the consulting world, etc., and the multilateral world, and now I'm back into business. But I think, that's the story. It started really young, and then it just matured, at different levels.
That's commitment. That is a level of compromiso that a lot of people don't even, it's hard to imagine at that young of an age to think that you would start your own business like that. Muito interessante, muito interessante mesmo. So we want to know a little bit more about this journey. You talk about your journey in entrepreneurship. You started with a very different beginning, but what has been, qual tem sido o seu momento mais orgulhoso, assim, nessa jornada, esse viagem longa que temos, assim, entrepreneurship?
Vou passar para o português, então, um pouquinho.
Pode.
Eu acho que uma das coisas que mais tem me orgulhado recentemente foi a questão da criação da minha empresa atual, a Dima. Né? Development significa gestores e assessores em desenvolvimento de impacto. E é uma consultoria que culmina muitos anos e muita experiência, seja no setor de consultoria, setor internacional, em TI, ou seja, é a culminação realmente de várias experiências, né? E eu acho que me orgulha tanto pelo fato de eu ter chegado, de eu ter feito isso, não no meu país de origem, mas num país totalmente diferente de todos os países que eu já vivi. É um país com uma religião diferente, com um idioma diferente, com uma cultura totalmente diferente. Ou seja, e eu cheguei aqui no Catar 5 meses grávida. Então, e já comecei a pensar quais são as oportunidades, quais são... Então, eu me sinto, assim, bastante orgulhosa dessa história de vida, de poder ter, ou seja, apostado...
Em você mesmo.
De estabelecer... Alô? Voltei?
Eu acho que você congelou um pouquinho. Can you repeat that part? You apostou...
Agora sim. Uhum. Não, eu estava dizendo que...
Ok. We're going to see if we can...
espero que... Agora
get
sim.
The connection. Yes, go ahead.
Então, ou seja, esse, digamos, this achievement of being in a country that is not mine, that is different, that is... You know, in a moment in my life that was quite sensitive and quite important to me, which was like having my first child, you know.
Yeah.
And I think to me that's a great achievement. Mm-hmm. I am.
So, everyone, we're having a few technical difficulties, but we're going to resolve it. Luana's going to, I think we're going to ask Luana to log out and log back in. And while she does that, we'll explain a few other things. Let's see. You know, tech, that's how it happens. We love it. It's a great way to, you know, to communicate, but we also have to figure out the glitches. So let's get this. All right, so while we're waiting for Luana to log back in, let's see if she's here again. Hello? Nope, still not here. All right, so we'll go to some more of our announcements. We want to make sure, as we talked about, like ways that people can support, ways that people can show solidarity with Black women-owned businesses. I want to make sure we here at Black Women Disrupt want to make sure that you don't forget to shout out, post a picture, send some love to a sister disruptor you admire and respect, and tell your friends. And don't forget to hashtag Black Women Disrupt so we can send her some love as well. It's important for us as we like and enjoy each other's content, as we participate in seminars and web series and Zoom calls. We should show love and support for one another in our social media space, the way you would shout out someone in real life and share and show that you appreciate the work that they do. So we're definitely encouraging people to do more of that and to find new Black women influencers and business women to support and follow. So I believe she came back in. Let's see if she joined us. If not, we'll have to figure out another way. There she is. Luana, you're back. She's here. Let's see if our connection will last. I know that this is also a challenging part of doing and bringing to you this kind of content, is that we're all in different places and trying to connect to one another. And sometimes technology lets us down just a little bit. So while we figure out what the glitch is, we're going to just keep on moving. I see some people are with us here in StreamYard. I see Peru is in the house. Hola, Sharon. I see Brazil is in the house. Maite, how are you? Black Women Disrupt, sister. I saw you on the front page of Examine magazine. I cannot believe you made the front page, not because I don't believe you should be there, but because you were the first Black woman to grace the front of that magazine. Here's Luana, she's back.
Yes.
Hola.
That's what happened. It was completely unstable. And then I don't know what happened, but let's see.
It happens to us all the time. We filled up the space with things we needed to say. We had to say. And I was shouting out some of the sister disruptors who are with us today. But you were in the middle of a very compelling story. You finished it in English, but if you can share with our sister disruptors the end of that, the part of being orgulhosa de estar e chegar em país totalmente diferente, 5 meses grávida, e que aconteceu?
Então, eu cheguei aqui sem saber o idioma, sem conhecer a cultura, a etiqueta da cultura, né? Uhum. E querendo muito, ou seja, identificar oportunidades, né? Uhum. E a coisa foi de que quando eu busquei saber como é que faz para abrir uma empresa aqui, porque uhum. a primeira coisa que eu me dei conta foi de que não existia uma entidade de aproximação. O Catar tinha muitos estereótipos errados da América uhum. Latina, né? Uhum. Ou seja, com quem eu conversava sobre investimentos e possibilidade de investimentos, eles, ou seja, me contavam de um filme que parecia um filme do Narcos. E eu disse, não, a América Latina não é isso, né? E, ao mesmo tempo, eu conversava com pessoas da América Latina e ninguém sabia nem onde era o Catar, o que tinha no Catar, ou seja... Pois então, é. Eu encontrei aí um gap muito grande, porque o Catar tinha liquidez, né? E nós não temos liquidez. Então, como que eu faço para ser o elo, né? E aí eu queria muito, ou seja, criar uma empresa desse tipo, mas eu me deparei com um grande problema, que é o Catar. No Catar, tu não pode abrir uma empresa sem ter um sócio catari que detém uhum. 51% da propriedade da tua empresa. E aí eu, puxa, com quem que eu vou fazer essa empresa? Com quem que eu vou criar essa empresa? Encontrar realmente um sócio. Até o momento em que eu conheci uma mulher catari que me mostrou o caminho das pedras e disse, não, existe uma possibilidade de tu criar uma empresa 100% tua. E eu estabeleci a primeira empresa 100% de propriedade de uma pessoa brasileira no centro financeiro do Catar. Então, acho que isso me dá muito orgulho, porque eu fui atrás perguntando. Foi, assim, uma busca incansável sobre como que eu posso fazer isso de maneira a preservar o meu protagonismo. Porque uma vez que tu estabelece uma sociedade de 51% de alguém daqui, tu perde a tua identidade, né? Então, realmente, eu queria esse protagonismo e consegui manter. Então, acho que por isso tanto me orgulha, né, poder ter estabelecido uma empresa aqui num ambiente que realmente é muito difícil de descobrir as coisas, né? Mas com o estabelecimento de relações principalmente com outras mulheres catares. Hoje eu dou aula na Universidade de Hamad bin Khalifa University sobre gênero e políticas públicas. E foram essas alunas que me mostraram os caminhos das pedras. Foram com elas que eu aprendi realmente a cultura, foi com elas que eu aprendi, né, o que está por detrás de todos os nossos preconceitos, né, com relação às mulheres árabes. Então, está sendo uma experiência fenomenal.
We are so proud of you. Estamos super orgulhosos de você. É, porque, como você falou, não foi fácil. Você tinha que buscar as informações. Não era um booklet, um boletim que eles, assim, quando, na chegada você recebeu. So, finding that pathway to what you want. You mentioned women, and I think it's super important that we talk about this too. Why is it important to organize with women in mind? What challenges are sister disruptors? And when we say sister disruptors here in the Black Women Disrupt space, we're talking about business women, usually business women of color, business women of African descent. What are the challenges that we're facing in the world at this time?
Yeah. No, it's crucial to organize anything, any initiative, any company with women in mind. We already know that women make better leaders during crisis, during recession. The evidence is there. It's like, I'm not inventing this, you know. You can see from the COVID pandemic, there is a study that came out that, you know, show that women, the number of deaths, the number of the speed of recoveries are much faster when women lead nations, right? And we know that from 2008 recession also, it was women-led organizations that recovered much faster. So we already know that it's not only a wishful, you know, thing to do, a nice thing to do. We know that it is important if we want to have better outcomes, you know, sustainability of our outcomes. So planning with women in mind is like crucial for any organization and creating those spaces. But I believe we, as women and Black women in particular, we know that in general, today, Zakia, only 6 countries in the world have laws where men and women are equal, completely equal in all aspects. Only 6 countries.
Yeah.
My job, 10 years ago, there was no one single country where women and men were exactly the same or treated equal under the law. So can you imagine that today we are talking about discrimination, legal discrimination, so institutionalized discrimination against women. So these are the, like, so it starts from there, the barriers that we face. And then when we add the layer of being a Black woman,
talk intersectionality.
What we are talking about, and I like a lot. Exactly. Uh-huh. And then I don't know if you've read him, José Carlos dos Anjos. Yes. He's a professor in my university. He's from Cape Verde. Yeah. And he talks a lot about the negative capital that our color of skin represents in our society. We enter spaces and we are already discounted. People don't even need to know that I have a PhD. My PhD is not same worth as somebody else's PhD.
Even though it came from Oxford.
Exactly, PhD in the same university.
Right. You're absolutely right.
Precisely. Yeah, but I mean, it's like, so us Black women, we not only face that institutionalized discrimination under the law and the institution in service provision, etc., which we know, we also have this negative human capital or negative connotation attached to our credentials. I mean, our the same way. So, I mean, we have many challenges to overcome. This is a topic that is dear to my heart. That's what I studied in my PhD. That's what I worked my whole life practically, you know. That's the reason why I decided to actually do economics, to study economics, because I thought these are the people who are actually making a laws or influencing policies that Absolutely. Affect us directly, and we are not among them, you know, and we do not even understand the narratives that are created about us to justify what they want to do, you know. So Absolutely. We need more Black women economists, we need more Black women in policy making, we need more women in every single sphere of every power single. And decision making. So
and we bring up this question to you because
we want to make a change.
Sorry, go ahead. Yeah, we bring this question up because literally, I know we're having a little bit of a delay, but literally when we started Black Women Disrupt, people would say, including Black men, and we love our brothers out there, but they would say, why are you starting an organization or this group, but just for Black women? Like, we need something for everyone. And I said, yes. But Black women also support our communities. We are doing a lot of heavy lifting. We are doing the work, and we don't often get a chance to center Black women in a discourse around any topic, around economic empowerment or economic justice, around development and development issues. It's a gender conversation, which then becomes universalized, and universalized is the default for white or mainstream or the majority culture. And if it's about how to support Black communities, historically it has been focused on needs and wants of the loudest speakers. And most often women, even though we also have plenty of power and are in these spaces, our participation is different. So we could be left from around the table when the decision-making comes. So I thank you for your response and thank you for giving us those gems. The next question is going to be in Portuguese. Qual papel, diz qual é o papel da inovação em seu trabalho? Por que é tão importante de pensar globalmente quando você construir e expandir seus negócios? So these are two separate questions, são duas perguntas totalmente distintas, mas eu acho que tem uma conexão. E eu gostaria de ouvir de você.
Tá bom. Tem sim, Zaquia, tem uma conexão sim, porque quando eu penso em inovação, a primeira coisa que me vem na mente é a questão de intercâmbio, de diálogo, de... Eu não consigo inovar sozinha num silo, isolada, dentro de uma caixinha. Não tem como inovar. Tu tem que intercambiar, tu tem que expandir as tuas fronteiras, verdade? E tu tem que expandir não só as tuas fronteiras geográficas, as tuas fronteiras de campo de conhecimento. Ou seja, te dou um exemplo, né? Quem está na sociologia, por exemplo, ao expandir seu campo de conhecimento para a história, para a economia, para ciências políticas, né? Até para o campo da psicologia, tu consegue inovar muito mais no teu campo da sociologia. Né? Quando eu olho para ciências econômicas, eu disse, poxa, esse economista aqui está falando sobre o quanto que, por exemplo, eu estudei isso no doutorado, qual que é o benefício da diversidade racial no desempenho de estudantes do ensino superior. E mostrei que quanto mais diverso racialmente nós estamos dentro da sala de aula, maior o desempenho não só dos alunos diversos, ou seja, negros e indígenas, mas dos não diversos, dos brancos, ou seja, todo mundo se beneficia, né, com a diversidade. Então, ou seja, isso. E aí, quando eu estava lendo as teorias econômicas, né, que tentam explicar esse tema, eles se focavam, em explicar o tema da proximidade, né? Por que que indivíduos diferentes, quando se aproximam, pode ou não ter benefícios? E aí eu parti, eles, tá muito incompleto essas teses na economia. Aí eu fui para a sociologia, eu comecei a pesquisar os cientistas sociais, e aí me abriu um mundo muito mais rico de explicações com relação a como que, quando tu aproxima, na verdade pode aumentar o conflito e pode diminuir o desempenho. Ou tu aproxima, dependendo do nível de diversidade, ou seja, maioria negra, maioria branca, ou seja, expandiu-se aí no meu horizonte as possibilidades de explicar o que os economistas estavam explicando de uma maneira tão reducionista, o problema, né? Então, por isso que para mim inovação é não só tu expandir a tua fronteira e conhecer novas pessoas, né? Conhecer novas culturas e trazer esses, eu chamo behavioral traits também, esses comportamentos que te beneficiam, ou seja, aprender, por exemplo, eu aprendi muito dos nigerianos em termos de autoestima, de como chegar na sala e ter presença, entendeu? E mostrar que eu estou ali para fazer um statement. I'm here to make a statement, you know? So, this self-esteem. So, I learn from each culture. Eu aprendo, né, de cada cultura um pouco e trago aquilo que é positivo para enriquecer o meu manancial. E aí, por isso que eu digo que está muito conectado a inovação com a globalização, ou estar no mundo globalizado. Ou seja, é inevitável a gente já pensar, nascer global, born global. É isso, é o nosso mindset, tem que ser. De agora, é o born global. Porque a gente não só aumenta o nosso impacto social e econômico que a gente pode ter com a nossa venture, e a gente também tem maior retorno econômico, né? A gente expande os nossos mercados, expande o número de pessoas que poderiam conhecer o nosso. Então a gente tem que passar de pensar só no nosso bairro, nossa cidade, no nosso país, e começar a pensar mais globalmente, com certeza.
Nós compartilhamos esse ponto de vista. Eu acho que é por isso que nós temos tanta compatibilidade, conversamos muito. I love how you brought this idea of cultural competency and the use of diversity in a way that actually helps us grow and adopting different practices that allow us to, you know, to decide what we want in our toolkit and what we don't want. And that expanding our vision is more than just including a few black sprinkles in the room. But I also get tripped up too around this concept of diversity then is just diversity of pensamento or diversity of thought. And I feel like I need to warn us that we need to see transformation, that it can't just be representation or diversity. It has to be transformation of the culture, of the space in which you're in. And through that exchange, you are transforming. Everything we touch, this is Octavia Butler, everything we touch changes us, and everything we touch changes that thing too. I'm paraphrasing, but I love Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower because it talks about that exchange between forces that create something bigger and better. So I'm fascinated by this. Our next question is about pivoting. Fantastic. Actually, it's about change. And so we're on the right track. How have you pivoted or adapted during the COVID pandemic? And what advice would you give sister disruptors who are facing major transitions?
This pandemic has been, I think, a very unique and special time for me. I think it's very hard, not only for myself, but for everybody to have that discipline, particularly when you are at home, your children are around you, you know, your husband around you. And I think creating that discipline that you are, particularly when you have your own business, right? Because I think when you work for somebody, they push you the discipline, right? So like you are forced to have that discipline because you feel compelled to show you are working, you know. But when you have your own business, you know, you have to self-discipline. And I think that has helped me a lot. COVID-19 made me reflect, self-reflect a lot into putting the same level of discipline of what a job would have put on me, me putting on myself, like me being my own CEO, you know, and just creating that. So, and I have learned a lot of, not learned because I was already doing, but I think I have matured a lot about the exercise of really planning my day, of maximizing productive hours in a day, you know, incorporating exercise and, you know, trying to get, I at the beginning I felt, oh, I gained so many hours because it was taking me like about an hour to go to the office, an hour to come back, you know, suddenly I have two extra hours, you know, and at the beginning I didn't see those two extra hours, you know, it was like they vanished. So I just felt, you know, let me plan my day. And that's what I do. I work with lists, lists, lists. You know, that is, you know, my day, that is always a checklist I need to check. And I feel so accomplished when I do that. And I mean, and that's my
I was going to say, I keep forgetting we have a delay. But this is the third time that lists has come have come up in our conversations with Sister Disruptors in this live series. Yep. That we are creating lists, we are going through the lists, we're feeling good about the list. And so, Sister Disruptors out there, that's a thing. So it must be the key to some success for all of us. Yep. Thank you, Sid Afordma.
But I think one thing that perhaps I didn't mention is this forward thinking and planning future wise, looking at the tendencies, what is out there, what is happening, what is likely to happen, what are the sectors that might be more strategic, you know. So I, on a normal day, I wouldn't have spent so much time thinking about that, you know. And I think with COVID, it has really inspired me to really start reading more and learning more about future tendencies and how can I take 10 steps ahead and be 10 steps ahead, right? Once we recover. So I think, that was to me, I think one of the most important aspects that I'm learning in this time.
So vamos também perguntar, mas perguntar essa mesma pergunta de uma outra perspectiva. Não a primeira parte, mas a segunda parte. Uhum. Como você equilibra todas as necessidades prementes que você pode enfrentar como mãe, como acadêmica, como empresária? Eu acho que esse COVID também está nos ensinando uma nova forma de equilíbrio. E não sei qual é ainda, mas qual seria o seu conceito?
Eu acho isso aqui assim, a primeira coisa que a gente tem que fazer é aceitar a situação, né? Porque eu já escutei muitas irmãs aí que elas ainda estão um pouco no negacionismo, né? Tipo, ainda estão chateadas com alguma coisa. Ou seja, a gente vai ter que aceitar que essa é a situação que a gente se encontra atualmente. No momento que tu aceita, tu começa a ver, ok, como que eu vou me ajustar? Né? Como que eu vou me ajustar de maneira que aquilo que eu estava falando, que a gente consiga planejar de maneira muito fria, né? Como que a gente vai poder se destacando lá na frente, né? Quais são os itens ali, por exemplo, eu decidi que eu ia escrever mais. Várias pessoas já tinham me perguntado, mas onde é que está o teu material, isso e aquilo? E eu disse, olha, eu não estou tendo tempo de escrever publicações acadêmicas elaboradas, mas todos os dias eu acordo com alguma ideia ou alguma coisa que eu quero falar, que eu quero, né? Ou eu vou fazer vídeo ou eu vou escrever, né? E eu me sinto mais confortável escrevendo. Eu tentei, eu até comecei um canal, eu vou trabalhar naquele canal ainda, no meu canal no YouTube, mas eu comecei a escrever. E não é que eu apenas escrevendo sem nenhuma intenção, sem nenhuma, digamos, apenas a intenção de compartilhar conhecimentos, eu fui convidada para ser colunista em duas revistas. Né? Ou seja, então eu acho assim que a gente tem que, no momento que a gente aceita e que a gente começa a trabalhar em cima das nossas fortalezas internas e o que, que nos move, né? A gente, ou seja, o sucesso vai vir. Né? Então a gente tem que celebrar a vida. E a outra coisa que eu vi que algumas irmãs fazem, elas se escondem dentro de um caramujo, né? Tipo assim, tá o Covid e ninguém encontra elas mais, né? Ou seja, ninguém ouve. E eu acho assim, eu entendo que tem uma pressão muito grande, principalmente as irmãs que têm já filhos que estão na escola e que elas precisam não só cuidar dessas coisas, fazer o trabalho da casa, dar aula para as crianças, ou seja,
girl, mas, everything.
Mas o que a gente tem que fazer, né, Zaki? E o que tu tem que buscar support systems, sistemas de apoio, né? Ou seja, sistemas de apoio. Eu entendo que às vezes os recursos são escassos, né? Mas a gente talvez pode pedir ajuda, né? Ou seja, muitas vezes a gente se esconde, a gente está ali no temporal e com medo de pedir ajuda. Né, e com vergonha de pedir ajuda. Eu acho que a gente tem que começar a pedir ajuda para a família, para amigos, ou seja, e contar com esse sistema de apoio para te poder colocar a cabeça, né, para respirar e tu poder te focar um pouco em ti mesma. A gente precisa se focar em si mesma e no nosso desenvolvimento pessoal nesse momento de crise.
E é uma parte de autocuidado também. Todo mundo gosta desse tema de autocuidado. Sim. Shout out to Anana Harris Perez, who wrote a fantastic book about self-care and Black women. But self-care has been one of these things that we, you know, I think COVID-19 has definitely taught us a new way of thinking about self. And like you said, we are doing everything. Mm-hmm. Black women are teaching our students at home, and we are, you know, working on our own businesses and working from home remotely and juggling a whole lot of things, but how do we actually like create an equilibrium? And I love you bringing up the point of systems of support and relying on others and asking people for help. Bonito. It's like absolutely something that we have to figure out how to do. We have so much. There's so many things I want to ask you. I'm going to narrow down a few of the questions. Let me see if anyone on our comments. Oh, Marissa Ann asks, ooh, what book is that? Marissa, we're going to post a link to Anana Harris Perez's book, Self-Care, about self-care and the journey for African-American women and women of African descent overall. And someone else said, it's disruptive to pull our chairs up to the table for this discourse. And I think Kami Jamila was referring to our conversation about what it looks like sometimes to just be present and have that self-esteem at a table. That's already almost a disruptive force because the status quo does not include us. Just apareciendo. And I want to shout out to Maite Lorenzo, who was here with us earlier today, because her front page of the Exame magazine in Brazil is like giving me everything to say. Mainly because we just don't get opportunities to see ourselves and to see ourselves on the front of a page in that way. So of a magazine in that way. So a couple more questions from us. What can the African diaspora, people of African descent like you and I, what can we do to strengthen our relationships across borders? You talked a little bit about starting a business in a new country and learning things from Nigerian culture, yep, about self-esteem and presence. Mm-hmm. What can we do to strengthen our relationship? What aren't we already doing, Luana?
No, I'll go in English for this one, or maybe half a half.
Maybe we'll do both, a little bit of both. Okay. Yeah.
Eu vou começar em português, então. Zaquia, tu bem sabe, nós somos afrodescendentes no mundo. Nós somos 1,8 bilhões de pessoas no mundo, né? E, obviamente, a maioria está no continente africano, mas a gente, nas Américas, tem pelo menos aí 200 milhões de pessoas, né? Ou seja, então a gente, mas a gente realmente, ou seja, não, historicamente, não fizemos muito para deliberadamente...
Oh, no, she didn't freeze in that moment. Luana, come back. She was right in the middle of dropping the goods. She started off in Portuguese responding to the question, what can the African diaspora do?
Alô?
Luana, please, yes, finish your thought.
Vou tentar.
We can hear you. Can you hear us? Eita. So... she started off by saying that we are over, we are billions, 1.8 billion, I believe is the number she said, of people of African descent in the world. The majority of people of African descent, of course, being on the continent of Africa, but that we are some 200 million plus here in the Americas. And so let's see if this works.
I came back with the phone. Just in case. Yes, I came back with the phone.
Let me fantastic. Put it here.
Yep.
Thank you. So. I was just translating a little bit what you said in Portuguese first, that, you know, we are in globally 1.8 billion, I think, people of African descent, the majority on the continent of Africa, that over 200 million of us live in the Americas, people of African descent living in the Americas, and we perhaps have not done enough, and then you stopped. Tell us more. No, she broke again. So, I will. There she is.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yeah. And this topic is so crucial. It's so important. Internet cannot fail us, and it's not gonna prevent us from talking. About this. No, I refuse to accept. No, what I was saying, you know, just to go straight to the point, we have not historically been so deliberate into finding ways to connect with one another, okay? Mm-hmm. Of course, we have had international conferences. The United Nations has instituted the Decade of the African Descent. But if you look really at the problem, the size of the problem we face, racism is a global pandemic. All of us face it, Africans face it. As long as they get close to people who have been close to colonial mindset.
Yeah. And this racism has infected us all. We're all living in this racism.
Right? So all of us, Africans living in the African continent and those Afro-descendants living outside, we all face the same problem of racism everywhere. So for a problem, are you still there, Zakia?
I am, I'm still here.
So for a problem, and that's I think the point where I want to get, a global problem requires a global solution. And that's what we have not been able to accomplish in a united front. So we still lack a platform or, you know, solutions really that are global. Look at, for instance, Robert Smith in the United States, Epsi Campbell in Costa Rica, Tony Elumelu.
I believe she was going to say Tonio. Uh-oh. Ah, it's frozen again. But she's citing different leaders of African descent
in Nigeria.
Wonderful. Yeah.
I mean, Maite Lorenzo in Brazil, Adriana Barbosa, Paulo Rogério, Leide in Colombia. I mean, we can name these leaders, awesome leaders that are doing amazing transformational things on their own. I mean, Qatar, yes, and I mean, but we still need an initiative or a solution or something that brings us together in a much more and use Zakia, just like this initiative of Black Women Disrupt, that you are connecting women from all over the world. And I think we need that. We need those alliances, cross-border, cross-national alliances to strengthen us so that we can come together and launch solutions for a problem that is global solutions. So I think one thing that I want to mention is the first time I mentioned.
Well, technology is not going to fail us, as Luana said. We are not going to stop. There she goes.
We have put together a team of people to work on an initiative called GLAAD. It's Global Leaders of African Descent, where we are going to bring together investors, entrepreneurs, influencers, be influencers in the media, or thought leaders, influencers intellectually, policymakers, ecosystem builders, really Afro-descendants from different spheres of life in different, and we are connecting with organizations in Australia, in Guam, in Japan, in Germany, so because they are everywhere. It's just that they are working in isolation and we cannot afford to do that anymore. So I think, and please be tuned.
I think she was going to say, stay tuned, fique ligado, porque isso está vendo que ela está desenvolvendo uma iniciativa também.
And it's something that's, yes, so it's something that we are working to launch this year. So please be tuned.
Absolutely. We'll be in touch, and you have, our support. We would be very excited to find ways to collaborate and to share information. One of the things I think is just so important right now is that we are connected and that we're finding these ways to, like you said, reach out. And I wonder if this pandemic had not happened, if we weren't in this particular moment where everyone is seeking justice in a very unique way, where we are realizing that systemic racism is as deadly as a true death, by a police officer, that this doesn't just happen in justice. It happens in economic places. Yep. It happens in finance. It happens in development.
Health, places, everything.
Everywhere. And if we assume that somehow, in the health sector, everyone is neutral because they're providing life-giving resources. Well, we live and breathe in a system that is unequal and is and has disparities. So absolutely. Now we're going to get the most lovely question in our time. But before we do that, I want to make sure we don't miss anyone else's. People are clapping. Glad. They love it. Estão apaixonados pelo GLAAD. Marley Olubuni Carolino from Porto Alegre.
Marley! Tudo bom, Marley? Que legal.
And I see you, Erika Pereira. I mean, people are showing up from São Paulo, from Porto Alegre. This is fantastic. They aren't asking you any question yet. Oh, there's one from Sharon Gonzalez. She's from Peru. She says that she perceives the business world as disassociated from social-oriented development. How do you reconcile both of your interests? And I know there may be a little bit of a delay and a little bit of a pause.
Can I you think see I that? Got the question. Yeah, I read it. How do I associate on my business with social impact? I think that is the main reason why I decided to create Development Impact is precisely to create that association between the two. So for instance, we are in the business of raising capital for venture capital funds, for instance, mm-hmm. right? We help VC PE funds to raise capital here in the Middle East. But I'm not gonna do that if I do not believe your fund is actually in the business of creating impact, social impact, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like, I know I'm sitting in a gold mine here, but through my business, I have the option or the, let's say, the freedom.
Yes. So we're experiencing some technical difficulties, but every time she comes back,
No, I was just saying that, yes, totally. I mean, it's my decision as a businesswoman with whom I work with, right? Who is my client, you know, who I choose to be my client. It's like, I'm not forced to work for a client, to fundraise for a client that I do not believe is having positive impact in communities. So, you know, so there are many ways to reconcile both. It goes to a choice of what is your priority as a business woman, you know?
Yeah, and we're learning this more. Like when we first studied business some 20 odd years ago, it was more difficult to imagine this social and business hybrid, you know, to imagine ourselves somewhere in between making all the profits and capitalism mm-hmm. is amazing to how can we incorporate social concepts and make sure that what we do and how we work has a positive impact on communities. I love it. Someone just mentioned, Jamila James mentioned, option and freedom is key. Yeah, we can choose and we're not held to a standard where we have to work with just any old client and do any type of work. We can make that decision about what the work would be and who the client would be.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Yep.
So we have one last question left. You see, I told you it would happen in 1 hour. We've made it like
it's fast.
Science.
Yeah.
This is the best question. Essa pergunta é a pergunta que eu gosto mais, porque sabemos que somos mulheres de negócios, e we are entrepreneurs, we are businesswomen, mas nós não ficamos num vacuum, nós não somos assim como businesswomen e mais nada, somos mães, somos de tudo que você pode imaginar. What are you listening to? What are you watching? What are you reading that is giving you life and inspiring you? Que você está lendo, assistindo, ouvindo, que está te dando alegria, vida, felicidade?
Não, com certeza, a música é o que traz vida, né? É incrível como, ou seja, a música dissipa estresse, dissipa negatividade, ou seja, e muitas vezes, né, eu gosto muito de ouvir músicas de empoderamento e de ativismo e tudo, mas quando realmente é algo assim, que eu quero realmente desconectar, porque a minha vida, ou seja, negócios, é tudo com relação ao ativismo, é tudo, então, às vezes eu realmente só quero dançar alguma coisa engraçada com meu filho. Ele gosta muito da Isa, da cantora Isa. E a gente dança, mas eu realmente, para eu conseguir, o que me traz muita emoção, por exemplo, por exemplo, eu tenho ouvido muito recentemente Kali 13. Não sei se tu conhece. Mas, ou seja, são músicas assim, eu gosto muito da Suzana Baca e essa música que ela fez com a Kali 13 e também com a Maria Rita, porque eu não sei porque essa mistura, tudo que a música que tem uma mistura de idiomas e, de ritmos. E de, eu não sei, é algo assim que meu espírito meio que, sabe? Tipo assim, eleva, né? Eu consigo, né? Tipo assim, então eu gosto muito, se chama Latino América, eu escuto várias vezes e tal. E com meu filho eu tenho escutado muito Isa. É, em termos de leitura, eu tô lendo coisas mais, realmente, tô focando muito no meu ativismo e aprendendo muito sobre os intelectuais como Achille Mbembe, que tem o The Reason, não? About the Black of the World, não? Mbembe fala muito do negro, ou seja, o negro do mundo, né? Isso que a gente está falando, do conceito de conectar, de nos conectar no mundo todo. E agora eu acabo de começar a ler o livro da Ilhan Omar, que é a senadora muçulmana. E eu também estou muito me interessando muito nessa intersecção entre religião, gênero e raça, né? Porque eu, ou seja, principalmente olhando para as feministas muçulmanas, ou seja, e entendendo a perspectiva delas, seja das mais conservadoras até as mais entender a perspectiva completa, porque tu nunca sabe quando que tu vai sentar de cara a cara com uma. E como que tu vai reagir? Tu precisa conhecer, né, as discussões e os argumentos. Então, eu gosto muito dessa parte. Eu sei que é uma parte que ainda continua, mas eu relaxo. Eu relaxo lendo elas. Mas em termos de música, realmente tem sido uma mescla de música brasileira, salsa, samba, ou seja,
e
aquela
tudo.
coisa mais em tudo.
A gente vai adicionar a música que você citou. We're going to add the song that you say you love from Susana Baca. Em Calle 13, não?
Calle 13.
And we're going to make sure that people have at least a link to know what the song is, so they can also be in the same spirit and feeling that you are in. Luana, we are going to wrap it up because we know you have lots of things to do.
It was a pleasure.
We appreciate you so much. We would often spend time talking and exchanging ideas, and it's just so good to be able to share that experience, that beautiful experience that I've always had having conversations with you with the world. And so thank you so much for agreeing to be with us today and for giving us, so much to be able to so much to be able to hold on to in this time. Before we go though, too, we want to show the article that you wrote. Mm-hmm. We're just going to put it up on the screen. And while we're doing that, let's see. I want to just know if everyone liked what they heard today. We appreciate so much Dr. Luana Ozimela. Her article is going to come out in English very soon. It's so important for you to read what she's been writing. It's very eye-opening about calculating the costs of racism. I hope it's going up on the page now.
Yes.
Muito obrigada, doutora Luana Ozimela. Eu sei que somos amigas,
obrigada.
Eu vou te chamar de Luana, mas eu sempre coloco doutora por frente, assim, porque eu acho muito importante que nós reconhecemos.
Obrigada, Zaki. Obrigada.
Não, imagine.
Obrigada.
Vamos adicionar os links do social media para as notas desse episódio hoje. If you like and loved what you heard today, like and follow Jima LLC. Like and follow Black Women Disrupt. Don't worry, this is just the beginning, sisters and friends. We are taking a week off, though. In the first week of July, we will be taking a break, but we've gotten so much positive feedback that we're going to continue and expand this summer series into July and possibly August. So stay tuned. We'll be back with a fantastic lineup in July. Actually, on July 10th, we'll be bringing you Mota Sui and Ori Cauris from Uruguay. Don't forget to like and subscribe and follow our special guest and join us for Black Women Disrupt Summer Series Live, Resistance, Resilience, and Innovation Follow us on social media, on Facebook and Instagram at Black Women Disrupt, on Twitter at Black Women Disrupt, or on our Black Women Disrupt YouTube. And if you like the t-shirt I'm wearing, hey, we also have the
t-shirt. I want one. How can I get the t-shirt here in Qatar?
We're going to put the link for you. And,
okay.
Sure that you get one.
Yes.
And we have other items also. We have a beautiful mugs. I only drink out of Black Women Disrupt mugs now.
Awesome. The water of life.
But just don't forget to shout out the Disruptor.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
It's so amazing. We're juggling. Bye, my love. How are you? How beautiful. He's getting so big. What is
he
this?
He can't hear him. He's just like, why is the light on?
I love it. But see, usually my children are running in. I'm so happy to see somebody else's child.
Thank you so much, Zakia, and thank you. You are such an inspiration for all of us, Zakia. I still remember when you took me around Howard campus and told me all about, you know, the civil rights movement when I knew so little, almost nothing, you know, and you took me to Sankofa Library and to the cafe, and I fell in love with Washington, D.C., and with, you know, just the African-American community. And you are true inspiration, and you are shortening rapidly the distance among women and men of African descent all over the world. And I want to continue working with you. I want us to do so much more, and I will be following everything, every move. So let's keep in touch. Love you.
Love you too, girl. I'm so proud of you. I just could not hold this in. I had to share you with everybody else. So we love you. Take care in Qatar. And
thank you.
Wonderful work, the work that we need. Sister, we need this. So I just, have a great day. Have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.
Give
you
hugs too. And love to the family. All right.
Yeah, you too. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
All right, you guys, we're gone. See you next. Well, we won't be next week. See you on July 10th. And we're going to be focusing on the Miss de Afrodescendencia in Uruguay. We're going to be looking at Black History Month or Black Heritage Month in Uruguay on July 10th. Take care. Have a great one. Bye.